Good morning, church. How are we all doing this morning? Well, get up on your feet. It says on the screen there, if you missed it, Sunday has arrived, and it's so good to be home on a Sunday. Amen. I'm so glad you have made it, actually, because you are the keen people who wanted to get to church. I have a bit of scripture to share with you this morning. It says in Philippians 2, verse 9, therefore God elevated him, which is Jesus, to be the place of the highest honor and gave him the name above every other name, that the name of Jesus, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth, and every tongue shall declare that Jesus Christ is Lord. I don't know about you, but I'm so excited for that day where everybody else can see the God that we worship. Amen. But right in this moment, I encourage you to know the God that you worship. Come on, church, this is not a time to be silent or be quiet or step back or feel intimidated. God wants to hear your voice. He wants to hear your heart. And even if you don't feel comfortable raising your hands, that's okay. But if you mean it from the heart, then he's going to be here. He's going to come. He's already been here at 9:30 service. Come on, church, he is the name above every other name. Let's give him his place this morning. He is the name above every other name. We're going to sing this out. Oh, 'cause you're the name above all names, oh, and you are worthy of all praise. Oh, and my heart will sing, how great is our God. Name above, yes, you're the
for a couple of days, even though I didn't really know him. But God spoke to me, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and says, see how that affected you that much and you didn't even know that person? How much more does it affect me when I know you? I created you and you ignore me. Church, I don't want us to ignore him this morning. We've set aside this time, this worship, just to focus on him. If you haven't had a moment to focus on him all week, that's okay, but now is your time to focus on the one who created you, the one who loved you, the one who called you by name. He has covered you in the blood of Jesus, and we celebrated that last week. We still do celebrate that. But he has called you by name. Let's not ignore the fact that he created us. He knows us more than we know ourselves. Come on, church, let's sing. Let's raise our hands if you feel comfortable and sing, he's the name above every single name. Amen. Yeah.
And is our God.
He's the name above every name.
Yes, you're the name above all. Oh, great are you.
to believe that he's going to come through and break through. So let's worship as if the miracle has happened. Let's worship as if he's here in the room, because he is.
Fragrance of heaven, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. A holy anointing, the power of your presence, pour your spirit out on us, pour your spirit out. Oh. Thank you.
Well, when you ask for the fire of God to come, the fire alarm gets set off. We got what we asked for. Father, we're thankful today for your presence with us. And we do pray, Lord, we need a fresh oil. We need a fresh wind. We ask you for that fire today, O God. Hungry for your presence today, O Lord. That's why we're here. So we bless your name, Jesus. You know, I was reminded that last week we had, in a sense, we dedicated this building. Last week we had our first service here, and Solomon built the Lord a house, and the Lord appeared to him the second time, and he said, I will write my name in that place. And more than that, he says, my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. And I want us to realize this morning that that is the heart of God for this house, where there is an assembly of people that's hearts are committed to him to walk before him and that are going to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. His eyes are here perpetually. His heart's here. That can be translated. His attention is here perpetually. And so there's no hiding place this morning. We have a God who sees amongst us today. And that's good news for us, each and every one of us today. So I don't know where you've been at. Maybe you've been feeling a bit down lately. Maybe you're like Hagar that doesn't know where life's headed and find yourself alone a little and just in that desert road, and God sees her. That woman in John 4 that nobody else really cared for and her life is a mess, God saw her. And we come to a God that sees today. And I love the thought that he comes to me, I'll no way cast out. That's the promise that we have from Jesus today. So Father, we just abandon every distraction, Lord. As Gemma said, you're here today. You're here, Lord. We're not coming to kill a few moments, Lord, or whisper up into the air. We thank you that the God of heaven is in this place today. And so, Father, I pray that you would minister to hearts. I pray that you would equip, you would encourage, and that people that have never encountered you before, Lord, may even meet you today for the first time. So, Father, we abandon every distraction, everything, and we've had one already, everything that would come against, as we try to press into your presence, Lord. And we thank you that we have your attention today. So, Lord, would you get ours? And we'll be careful to give you all the glory today, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. You can have a seat. It's so good to see you all. And today I say it's great to be meeting in person again and not seeing your virtual self, as nice as that was. It's great to see everybody here together. I want to welcome our online audience as well. They've joined us for the half 11 service, Facebook, all those guys. You want to give them an encouragement as they join us now as well. So good to be together. Just want to mention as well, for the guys that are online, there are online pastors there. You can get in touch. If we can serve you, if we can help you in any way, please get in touch with the guys online. There's people there to help you. And again, here just as well, you'll have passed. We have a Next Steps lounge on the way in. Look, if you're new to church or you've been coming for a while or even you've been here for a lifetime, if we can help you in any way, we'd love to do that. There'll be a team of people at the back just after the service here. And you can also jump online. We've got this fancy new website, gpastures.co.uk/next-steps. And there'll be people there that will love to sort of encourage you to get to know your God and find your place even here and even discover your purpose for your life. So we'd love to help you and serve you in any way that we can. I'm going to embarrass somebody here. There's Neil. Neil, would you stand for a wee minute? Not like this. Neil has been serving his country and has been away for months. I think it was way before Christmas, and he's just home recently from a tour with the forces, and he's just home recently. He's missed Rhonda and the girls for months now. So can we encourage Neil that's back with us today? God bless you, bro. Great to have Neil back again in our midst today. So good. So good to see him back safely. So we're going to continue to worship the Lord now just as we bring our offering to him. This week we had the death of a prince in our nation. And I said earlier, I didn't know the man, but you know, last week we had the death of a king. And this week, tributes have been pouring in, and now we have our opportunity to bring tribute to our King, the one who gave everything for us and who gave us all. So the ways to give are going to be coming onto the screen. There'll be a wee video. We're still encouraging the online giving. We don't want to be passing buckets or anything like that, trying to stay safe. But for the old timers that still like the envelope, there are some buckets at the door just as you go out. So we're going to see the ways to give on the screen now, and we'll do that. And then we're beginning a new series today in the Gospel of John, the I Am series, and Jade's already shared a wonderful word this morning. I know you're going to be blessed with that as you listen in today. So thank you so much.
Good morning. Good to see yous. You know, as I walked in to church this morning, the wonder that I felt in my heart as I walked in to this new building, this land that God has led us into. Church, may we never lose the wonder of what God has already done in our midst. And guess what? It's only the beginning for us, Green Pastures Church. Is anyone excited for what God is going to do in our midst? We can encourage him this morning. We can put our hands together. You know, and we also want to say, if you're watching online this morning, we're so glad you have joined us. There's something about being together. I know for us, being together in the room is fantastic, but also for those watching online, we pray that you feel God's presence this morning. We pray that he speaks to you. We find ourselves easing out of this lockdown season. And like, I know we're not there yet, like, it's a slow process, but we're easing out, we're heading in the right direction. But it would be completely naive of us to think that when the restrictions lift, everything is going to go back to normal, and all of our problems are going to disappear. That would be completely naive of us to think. You see, people have lost loved ones. Businesses have struggled and some have not made it. Relationships have broken down. People's mental health has been so badly affected. But you're so glad you came to church this morning. That is encouraging stuff, isn't it? No, we can be real in church today. We can be real here. If you can't be real in church, there's nowhere you can be real. And I know there are so many people in this room, and you're facing and walking through really real stuff, really tough stuff. And so we knew that. We met a few weeks ago, and we were trying to plan out what our next teaching series would be. We said, where is our church right now? Where is the world right now? What could we bring to encourage the people? And we talked about maybe looking at mental health and what does the Bible say about our mental health. We thought the world is in an identity crisis. Maybe we should look at the Bible and see what the Bible tells us about our identity. But then there was this point in the meeting where we all came into agreement and we just said, hey, maybe instead of looking at the problem, we should just strip it back and turn our eyes to the answer. You see, the answer is Jesus. I don't say that flippantly this morning. That's not just something that we say in church. No, Jesus is the answer to all the problems the world is facing right now. And so for the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at these seven I Ams of Jesus. These are not just things that people have said about Jesus, not things that the disciples have recorded about Jesus, but these are statements that Jesus makes about himself. There's other times in the Bible, there's one, I think it's also in the book of John, when Jesus says to his disciples, "Who do you say I am?" And Peter says, "You're the Son of God. You are the Christ." We know it as the Great Confession. This is not what we're looking at today. We're looking at what Jesus declares about himself. He says these seven I am statements. He says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. I am the resurrection and the life. I am." You know, the Bible echoes itself constantly. And here we see Jesus says, "I am." He says it in the exact same way and manner as we read in the book of Exodus. When Moses sees this burning bush, when God appears to Moses as a burning bush, we know it was on fire, it was not being consumed. And God said to Moses, "Moses, I want you to go back to Egypt, the place that you've ran from, and I want you to tell Pharaoh to let my people go." And we know this story. There's this internal battle that goes on in Moses. He's feeling insecure. He doesn't think he's the right person to do it. But eventually he says, "Okay, God, if I go, who will I say has sent me? What will I tell them your name is?" And God says to Moses, "Moses, I am who I am. I am who I am." What does that even mean? We read that and it feels so powerful. We're like, what does he mean? "I am" speaks of Yahweh, the absolute power of God. The God that exists outside of time, the God that was in the beginning and will be in the end, the God that is, that was, and is, and still is to come. Yahweh, I am. What do you need this morning? What do you lack this morning? He says, "I am. I am." And so my prayer is today and over the next few weeks as we look at these I am statements of Jesus, I pray that we would be encouraged that he is everything that we need. We can so often look at what Jesus has done, and he has done great things. But we're going to take time to look at who he was. Come on, we serve a great God. We serve a great God. Let's pray this morning before we open the Word of God together. God, we're thankful this morning that we get to be together. We're thankful that your presence is here. You say in your word, where two or more are gathered, you're in the midst of them. And so thank you, God, that your presence is here today. God, I pray that these words that I have would not just be empty words, but God, I pray that by your Spirit you would speak to hearts and minds today. God, we say that our hearts are open to receive from you. So we ask you to speak this morning. And above all else, we pray that your name would be glorified in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We're going to be reading from John and chapter 6. And just to give you a little bit of context here, before this happens, we've seen the feeding of the 5,000, where Jesus takes this little boy's lunch and he feeds what it says 5,000 people. Scholars believe that that was 5,000 men. So it was anything between 15 to 20,000 people fed on this little lunch. One of, I believe, the greatest miracles that Jesus ever performed. And after the miracle happens, Jesus takes himself off to the mountainside. And the disciples leave shortly after him. And then we see that later on that night, the disciples are out in a boat and Jesus appears to them on the water. He walks on the water. And right after that moment, it tells us that the next morning, the people, the crowd, the followers and the other disciples of Jesus, they wake up and they realize that Jesus is gone. The people that experienced the miracle, they didn't realize he had left. But they wake up the next morning and they're like, Jesus is gone and his disciples are gone. And so we're reading here from verse 25 and it says, when they found him on the other side of the lake, they ask him, Rabbi, when did you get here? Jesus answered, very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval. Then they ask him, what must we do to do the works that God requires? Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. So they ask him, what sign then will you give us that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, very truly, I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, always give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me and you still do not believe. All those the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. I will never drive away. Today we are looking at this first I am statement of Jesus. I am the bread of life. I have to be really honest that when I looked over the seven I am statements, I kind of thought, the bread of life is like the least good one. You know, it's like, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. I'm the door. I am the light of the world. And then it's like, I am the bread of life. You know, I think the reason that we can so often look over this and miss this is because the way we view bread in our culture today. See, for us, bread is no special thing. When we talk about people living in poverty or we talk about people who are in prison, we say they were living on bread and water. When we are eating healthy or we're on a diet, when we're shredding for the wedding or we're cutting out carbs for marbs, someday we'll be on holiday again. Someday soon. Just declare it in church. We'll speak it out. It's happening soon. But the first thing that goes is bread. One of our favorite things to do is to go out for dinner. We've really missed doing that. And we love to go up to Belfast and go shopping for the day. Well, I like to go shopping for the day. Timmy likes to sit in a coffee shop. And then we go for an early dinner in Belfast, and I love it. And you know, when you're planning on going for dinner, you kind of save yourself all day. You know, you don't really want to eat too much. You don't want to ruin your dinner. But then when you get into the restaurant and you sit down and you order their drinks, they bring out bread. They set it in the middle of the table, and it's like, you go mad for it. You're like, bread. But then there's always this moment between me and Timmy anyway where I'll look at him and I'll say, Timmy, don't eat too much bread because you're going to ruin your dinner. You see, I don't know why he thinks I'm so bossy, honestly. But you didn't come for the bread. You came for the steak or the pasta or the risotto, whatever you like to order when you're out. You didn't come for the bread. The bread was the appetizer. The bread was the side dish. You didn't come for bread. And sometimes, you know, when you're in maybe a fancy restaurant and they'll say to you, do you want to add on some bread and oils, you know, for an extra £5? You're like, no, I don't. I didn't come for the bread. I didn't come for the bread. But you see, that's why we can look at this and we think, this is such a strange thing for Jesus to say about himself. But actually, in Jesus' day and in this culture of this time, bread was not the side dish. Bread was not the appetizer. Bread was the main thing. In every single meal that they had, bread was the main thing. They would say, do you want some meat with your bread? Do you want some vegetables with your bread? Bread was the central thing. It was bread. We know that the word bread is mentioned over 300 times in the Bible. We read in the New Testament, the early church, they went in and out of each other's homes, and it says that they broke bread together. Sometimes we can picture that and think, you know, of the emblems, you know, the little pieces of bread and the little things of juice that we take at the front of church. But no, they were breaking bread. It's what they did. It was the meal. And as they broke bread, they remembered Jesus. Bread was a huge part of their life and was central in their culture. And we've just read here in the text that this crowd who have seen Jesus perform this great miracle, a day later, realize he's missing. And they catch up with him and they say, hey, Rabbi, when did you get here? But it's almost like they're saying it in this awkward way because they realize and they're embarrassed that they didn't notice he was gone until the next day. But Jesus, who isn't afraid ever to say it how it is, I love that about him in the Bible. He says, guys, save it. I know why you're here. You're not here because you've seen the miracles I've performed and you believe in who I am. You're here because you've ate the bread, you've had your fill, and your stomachs are empty again. You're here because you're hungry. He says, do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. What's interesting to note here is later on down in this passage, we see that many followers and disciples of Jesus walked away from him after these teachings. Not the 12 disciples, but other disciples we know that were there because they could not accept some of the things that Jesus was saying about himself. If you have been part of church, any church, for any period of time, you will know that people come and people go. And I don't mean they come and they go to other churches. That's a different thing. I mean they come, they get saved, they're on fire for Jesus, they're excited, they believe God's going to do something good in their life, and then all of a sudden, something happens or doesn't happen, and they walk away. I thought Jesus was going to give me a husband. I thought Jesus was going to make all my problems disappear. I thought Jesus was going to fix me. And they don't see it. And what happens is that they walk away. We realize that they were never really in it for the relationship, but they were only in it for the benefits. They were only in it for the benefits. And so they go out into the world trying to find that temporary fix. You know, as humans, we are so focused and distracted by the temporary things. Let's be honest, in church this morning, I can admit that. We are so distracted by the temporary things, the quick fix. We just want God to come into our lives and fix it and fix us. We don't want to wait. We don't want to walk out the process. But here's the thing, that God will challenge in us, and what he is maybe challenging us this morning as a church is, what are your intentions? Will you come to me not just for my benefits, but will you come to me for a relationship? Will you come to me for a relationship? See, the days that we're living in, we get things so quick and easy. We're described as the microwave culture. We get things at the click of a button. We don't have to wait. You might be thinking, hey, you don't know me. I've had a hard life. I've had to work hard for what I have. But even go back a few generations. Let's think about our grandparents or our great-grandparents. They didn't have things. Things weren't as accessible as they are for us. And so we live in this culture where people want the power of God, but they don't want the person. And they want the miracle, but they don't want the man. And they want the crown, but I don't want the cross. I want the blessings. Oh God, give us the blessings. We love the blessings, but I don't want the burden that comes with the blessings. And yeah, I want the glory, but no one told me there was going to be suffering that came with the glory. And Jesus says, no, I know why you're here. You came for this physical bread. You've showed up just in time for breakfast. Jesus says, I could provide enough bread for 1 million people if I wanted to right now. But all that would do is fix this temporary state of hunger. But I have come to give you something so much greater. I have come to fill this hunger in your soul, which is of eternal value. Maybe you're here or you're watching this morning online and you're frustrated with God. It happens. We don't like to admit it. I think I would never get frustrated with God because, like, he is God and I'm not, and he knows what he's doing. But actually, behind the scenes, we are frustrated because we are praying and we're asking and we're not seeing the answer. Can I tell you something today? That sometimes God will not meet your expectations. Sometimes God will not meet your expectations because he wants to exceed your expectations. Sometimes God will not meet them because he wants to exceed them. You know, Jesus will not withhold any good thing from you. If Jesus is holding out on you today, it's only because he has something better lined up for you. And he says, I know why you've came. You've came for this, but what I have for you is so much greater. I am the bread of life. I am so much greater than the things that I have done. I am so much greater than the things I have done. I am the main thing. I'm not the appetizer. I'm not the thing that you get before you get what you've came for. I am the main thing. It's me. I am the bread of life. I am everything you have been longing for and waiting for in your life. I am the bread of life. I wonder this morning what expectations you have placed on God for your life. I promise you, he will exceed every single one of them if you let him. If you would just hand your life over, I promise you, he will exceed every single one of your expectations. He will exceed every single one of them. The Bible tells us that he is able to do immeasurably more than we could ever hope, dream, imagine in our wildest dreams. He can do immeasurably more. So much that we can't even measure it. He can do so much more than we had ever hoped or imagined. This conversation with Jesus goes on, and they go back and forth, and they come back to him and they say, okay then, give us a sign. Give us a sign so we can believe you. As if they haven't already had enough signs at this point, he says, give us a sign. They said, our ancestors, they were given a sign when Moses gave them bread from heaven. See, what they are talking about here is, you remember at the start we looked at Moses? Well, Moses, he went back to Egypt. He led the Israelites out of Egypt. And they're now in the wilderness and they're hungry. And so God provides this manna for them. This bread from heaven. This is not just like Brennan's bread or Hovis. No, this is heavenly bread. The Bible says it was white and fluffy and it tasted like honey. This was like amazing bread. And when the Israelites would come out in the morning, there would be bread all over the ground. But there were some conditions that came with this bread. Not big, difficult conditions, but conditions nonetheless. God said to the Israelites, he said, only take what you need for the day. Only take what you need. I promise there will be enough, but only take what you need. He says, don't stock it up. Don't try and plan ahead. Take what you need. And then on the sixth day, you can take what you need for the seventh, because on the seventh day, we're going to rest. But he says, don't take more than you need those other 6 days. And you'd think the Israelites would say, hey, thanks, God. That is a great deal. That is a great deal. All we have to do is go and grab it, and there's our food. But you know, the Bible tells us that some of them went out and they took more than they needed. And they took it back to their tents and they started to stock it up and pile it up for the future. It's our human nature to want to plan out, to see what it's going to look like, to have a plan. But you see, when they woke up the next morning, we know that the bread was spoiled. The Bible tells us that there was maggots coming out of it. It was inedible. See, God was trying to teach the Israelites this lesson, and maybe it's the same lesson that he's trying to teach us today. If you're going to walk with me, if you're going to follow me, if you're going to live for me, then you're going to have to learn to depend on me daily. If you're going to give your life to me, then you're not going to see the next 40 years planned out. It doesn't work like that. He said, you're going to have to come. And you're going to have to trust me daily. You're going to have to believe that I am going to be enough for you. Yeah. It's going to be a journey. See, we have to be careful how we read this. It says, he who comes to me will never hunger. Many can take that for face value and can read that in the wrong way. You see, they can come to Jesus and they say the sinner's prayer, you know, and then that's it. I'm filled. I've said the sinner's prayer. I'm done. And they walk out of church and they say, thank you, Jesus. You have fixed me. I am good now. Don't worry. I'll make sure I come to church at Easter and Christmas and I'll pay tithes towards you. See, they've totally missed the point. Jesus is not saying, come to me once. He's speaking of people who are arriving and people who are returning, coming back and forth to him. What Jesus is saying, if you walk with me, if you get to know me and the person that I am, you will never know hunger. What Jesus is saying, you don't have to come and fill your pockets. It's not an all you can eat. He says, come when you need me. Come daily, 3 times a day, whatever you need. Are you tired this morning? He says, come to me. Weary, brokenhearted, come to me. Are you having a good day? Come to me. Are you having a bad day? Come to me. He says, he who comes to me will never know hunger, will never leave hungry. This conversation continues on, back and forward, back and forward. And the crowd at this point, it says they are grumbling. And they say, well, then what work do we have to do to receive this bread? There must be a catch, right? Because the gospel is just too good to be true. There must be a catch. What work do we have to do to receive this heavenly bread? You see, we know there was many Jews in this crowd, many Jewish people. And ever since, way back in the book of Genesis, when Adam and Eve brought this curse upon us, upon humanity, they have been used to having to work for their bread. It says this in Genesis, cursed is the ground for your sake. And you shall eat of the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you will return. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread. And so they thought, if we were going to get this bread from heaven, these Jews in the crowd, they're used to having to jump through hoops and tick boxes and bring sacrifices. They're saying, we're going to have to work for this heavenly bread. We're going to have to work for this bread that brings life. But Jesus says, you don't have to work for it. You just have to believe in me. You just have to believe in me. You see, Adam brought the curse upon you, but I have come to break the curse. I have come to break the curse. And so this bread of life, you don't have to earn it. You don't have to strive for it. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to be perfect and have all of your ducks in a row. He says, all you have to do is believe in me. You know, not long after this, we would see Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. He knew the cross was coming, and it said, sweat drops of blood fell from his face onto the ground. Sweat drops of blood fell from his face onto the ground. He says, you don't have to sweat for this bread, because I'm going to do that for you. And later he went to the cross. He went to the cross to do what? To reverse this curse, so that we no longer had to strive and work for life eternal, but all we have to do is believe in him. Would we never get tired of what he has done on the cross for us? As we read on down to that last bit, he says, and whoever comes to me, I will never turn away. Say never. Whoever comes to me, I will never turn away. That word there, when he says, who comes to me, is erkomai. And it doesn't mean to just approach God. No, it speaks of us falling onto him. And so we see this picture of people coming before Jesus. And they're so hungry, not the type of hunger that we feel when our dinner is 20 minutes late. No, but they're so hungry to the point of exhaustion. They have nothing left in them. And they come before Jesus and they fall at his feet. He says, erkomai, come to me, all who are hungry. You know, that world out there that we live in is starving. It's starving. We've seen this week all over the news, even in our own country, the hurt and pain and bitterness that we are still living in. Do you know what that is? It's starvation. People are starved of Jesus and they don't even know it. Jesus says, come to me. See, we don't think that they deserve it. We don't think that they deserve it. But Jesus says, I will never turn anyone away. I will never turn anyone away. Can we pray for our country? Can we pray for those who are starved of Jesus? There is nothing else that will fix this, only Jesus. I don't want you to think this morning that this is a message just for the unsaved. No, this is a message for the church this morning. This is a message for the church because it's, and I'm sad to say this, but the church today, and I'm not just speaking this church, I mean Big C Church, global, Christians are hungry. They're hungry. And they're going into the world and trying to fill the void. They're trying to be satisfied by things in the world. The church is hungry. And Jesus is saying, if you would just come to me, you will never know hunger for anything else. Come to me. You know, as the worship team comes forward, I want to take a moment. I know God is speaking to hearts today. Maybe you have felt challenged by this, that Jesus has been a bit of a side dish in your life. Maybe you've been keeping him over here and he's great for church and Sundays, but then during the week, there's other things that you're filling the void with. I don't know what that is. If that's alcohol or relationships, whatever. But Jesus is saying, come to me. And so if you feel like he's speaking to you this morning, I promise you, in the next few moments, you can just come to him. You don't have to let shame keep you away. That's what the enemy wants. But Jesus is saying, come to me today. Come to me with your emptiness. Come to me with your brokenness. Come to me with your shame. Come to me. And I promise you will not go out the same way you came. Will you stand to your feet this morning with me, church? We're going to take a moment in the presence of God. Let's close our eyes. Let's not look around at what anyone else is doing. I wonder if the Holy Spirit has been prompting you this morning. Maybe Jesus has been on the side a bit in your life. Or maybe you haven't been dependent on him. Maybe you've been trying to work it all out for yourself. Or maybe you've been striving for his love. In this moment, he's saying, come to me. Maybe you're in here today and you've never came to Jesus before. You've never accepted that bread of life. Maybe today is your day. He says, come to me and I will never turn you away. I will never turn you away. If that's you this morning and you want to make that decision to come before Jesus, would you just raise your hands after the count of three? 1, 2, 3. You want to accept Jesus. You've been hungry, searching for things in the wrong places. Just pop up your hand. Yeah, I see your hand. I see that hand. God sees you this morning. God sees you. Is there someone else this morning? Maybe someone, you've been away from him. You made a decision when you were younger. And you've been trying to do it on your own. Is there someone else today? I'm going to leave that there. I believe that the presence of God is here and is speaking to hearts in this room. We're going to worship Jesus now. And like, I know we can't all come up to the front like we maybe used to and respond to the altar call, but you know, see right where you're sitting in your seat, right there, you can have a moment with Jesus today. Come on, church, let's not walk out those doors the same way we came in. Let's leave filled this morning. Come on, let's put our hands together for Jesus. He's so good. He's so good.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me.
You are my daily bread.
Jesus.
that created the heavens. Find me now, where your grace runs as deep as your scars. You pulled me from the clay, you set me on a rock, you called me by your name, made my heart whole again. Lifted up in my knees, know it's all for your glory, that I might stand with more reasons to sing and to fear. You pulled me from the clay, you set me on a rock, you called me by your name, you made my heart whole again. Here I stand, high in surrender, I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever, my soul cries out. Once I was broken, you loved my whole heart through. Sin had no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds me. The ground where you break it,
chains are now. Death has no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds that crown.
Hallelujah. What a thought this morning. That once I was broken, but he loved us the whole way through. What a Savior, what a God we have this morning. Come on, can we give the Lord a praise again, just that we could eat the bread, that he could eat the bread of the sweat of another man's brow. That's the gospel today. But let's encourage Jade for that message that she's brought to us as well. Thank you so much. Look, as always, if we can help you, any questions you have, if we can help you in this journey of faith, what it is to believe in Jesus, what it is to walk this journey, there's people at the back that would love to speak to you that have the lanyards on. Please come and connect with us. We'd love to be able to lead you in any way that we can. And also, the pastors are still online for you. Those of you that are still watching on Facebook and online, you can jump onto our website, and there's pastoral care there as well. So I want to thank you so much for coming today. If you'll allow me, let me just say a wee blessing before we go. If you want to hold your hands out. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide upon you and your house from now until Jesus comes or calls. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for coming out this morning. We'll see you again soon.